you and share a few things with you before we roll in. Once again, my name is Ryan Fitzgerald, I'm Associate Professor in the Department of Mathematics. So just a little bit about my background. I have a Bachelor's of Science in Mathematics and a Master's of Science in Applied Mathematics from Hampton University. And I went on to Virginia Commonwealth University and Medical College of Virginia campus and earned a PhD in biostatistics. So that's just a little bit about myself. And then let's talk a little bit about my journey. So I did this picture for you, but it's not about math, facts, of course, but it's a father holding a daughter. So I think that that was kind of relevant to start my journey. My father was a math major, so here at Norfolk State University, actually. So it's kind of weird, kind of brings you kind of full take, you know, full circle. So my journey may be different than a lot of other people. A lot of people grow up in houses where they're a little afraid of math, and that was definitely something that was very different from myself. Like I said, my father was a math major here at Norfolk State University. I'm the baby. I have an older brother who's 5.5 years older than myself. Yes, could you guys guess what my brother's major was? My brother was a mathematics major as well. He went off to Virginia Tech. Actually, guess what? He transferred here to Norfolk State University and finished as a mathematics major. And he is currently a math teacher at Maury High School here in Norfolk, Virginia. So he, like I said, so we really come from a math family. So that's why I just kind of thought that picture was kind of cool. So like I said, my journey is a little bit different. You know, literally grew up in a house where everybody really was math. And it was one of those things, if you had to write a paper, that might be something a little bit different. I might be able to slide a little bit there, but grades could not slide definitely in that math courses. You had to be on par. I'm born and raised in Williamsburg, Virginia. And you'll see another slide in a moment, but like I said, in high school, definitely was never afraid of math, but I think one of the biggest things for our students, you know, getting them involved in STEM, of course, is that exposure piece, and that's actually my first bullet on this slide. But talking about that exposure, right? So of course I was exposed to it pretty early in life. It's kind of cute. I really wanted to try to find this video of my nieces. So I have two younger nieces who one middle and elementary school, and both because they had grown up kind of like I did in that house where math is something that everybody gets. It's so cute watching them grow up and see my brother kind of push them, you know, in different ways. Very different. So mind you, my niece, when she's barely talking, gets a piece of fruit, you know, so like a piece of melon, and she goes, trapezoid. Like she can barely talk, you know, she looks at this piece of fruit, she identifies that it looks like a trapezoid. I'm like, what did she say? Oh yeah, it really does kind of look like a trapezoid. You know, so literally that exposure, I think, truly is key, but everybody can't have that kind of background, you know, where, you know, many of them come from these backgrounds where, you know, parents might have been a little afraid of that. So how do we help them, you know, gain that exposure if they're not getting it at home? My thing, of course, I got it at home, but then once I really got to high school, one of the things, one of the things that I think was key was in high school, a club. And I think it still exists, but it's really strange. I was a part of Weaver and Chrome, you know, so if you were interested in math and the sciences, you were a part of Chrome. And as I kind of look back over it now, it's very strange. Most of those students that were in the Chrome Club are engineers now. You know, they truly are engineers. I started off, I actually went to school as an engineer. Unfortunately, I went on a track scholarship running cross country indoor outdoor track, so I ended up changing my major from engineering to math. You know, because it was, oh, if you're good in math, go be an engineer. That's kind of what we were truly, truly exposed to. And I remember back then, we went and visited, you know, we were exposed to many different things. We took a trip out to the University of Virginia, you know, to visit their Department of Engineering in high school, you know, and we took this big trip and we were just exposed to those different things. And we also went to, it used to be a refinery in Yorktown, Virginia. I don't think it's used as a refinery anymore, but it was a BP, Emeco, like refinery, you know, just different field trips. We were truly exposed to many different things and many careers early one in life, so that we really, you know, really, like go-getters, let's go do this. We really want to do that. And like I said, as I look back and count on my hand, many of those that were part of this Chrome Club, many of them are engineers today. So that was something really having that exposure really pushed and helped. And my talk more so is guided towards trying to encourage that STEM and strengthen the STEM. And so, of course, like I said, one of the main things is that exposure. The next piece is to help try to develop these critical thinking skills. We kind of get into this, you know, pace today where we, even now in college, right, I put something in the calculator, and if the calculator spits that out, that must be the answer. That is the solid goal. I didn't think anything about it. I just typed it in, and these are things, even today in college, I have conversations with my students, especially my upperclassmen students, you know, where I'm probability and statistics, and I'm thinking, your answer doesn't make sense. You know, you're trying to calculate a probability, and you just gave me a negative number. Not happening. You know, so that types of things. So just develop these skills to where we're actually analyzing, you know, what we're actually doing. And I think we need to start that truly at an early age, you know, not just, and it's hard, you know, we have so many things that we need to keep, you know, on task, you know, and secondary schools, you know, we're trying to get through testing, you know, and SOL testing and this, that, and the other. In my, right now, you know, we have to make sure we cover all the material. So how much time do I have to stop, you know, and make sure that we develop all these skills because I need to stay on task, you know. So these things are definitely things that are very hard, but I think that are very, you know, important that we stop at each topic or each thing that we're doing and see what it is that we can do to help develop these critical thinking skills and at an early age. And then the next thing is to help to actually encourage mathematical discourse. So we want to talk about the math. And actually, that sounds weird, but we want to write about the math as well, which is something that's a little bit different. We really don't think about writing in our math courses. And a lot of the times, my students laugh at myself. I find myself, when we're talking about a new topic, where I find myself repeating myself quite a bit. Right, but I'm repeating myself because I want them to get that process in their heads. I want them to start trying to analyze and attack the problem that they're looking at and the steps, you know, I have to recognize something. And then once I recognize it, what is it that I want to do big picture? And once I realize what it is that I want to do big picture, how do I go about doing that? You know, how do I go about doing that? And I actually get them to stop and go, write down certain things that you want to do so that it's clear to you, you know, write down what certain things mean to you. Right? So write down what it means to you. And like I said, we don't do a lot of writing in math. We think it's just, you know, go solve the problem. But I think this helps to see what your students are thinking. You know, it helps to see where they're thinking. And we might be able to intercept some of these misconceptions that they may have, you know, when they're talking about the math and learning about the math and those things. So I think that's something that we need to try to implement a little bit more in those situations. And then also note-taking and studying skills, which is something that we don't talk about that much. But I think it's something that's very important. And I have to stop in my college class and, you know, I'm walking around and I'm looking at their notes and their notes look like garbage. Like there's nothing there, and you know, and so they're trying to figure out, and they've never learned how to properly take notes or to properly, or forget if they have the notes, then of course go back and study. So that's one of the things that, you know, even as an early age, how do we get them to start trying to work on these types of skills, right? Because I have to build that confidence up in these courses. These topics and these areas in our STEM fields are things that sometimes may be challenging for someone, you know, it may be a little challenging for them. And I think it's very important for them to learn how to do things in a good manner that will help promote them to be successful in those fields. So like I said, definitely things like that, just trying to make sure that we're trying to take notes well, because they really, like I said, they truly don't. And I said, okay, when you leave here, what are you going to look at? You know, what is it that you're going to have? What is it that you can fall back on? And then as well, so that's something that's definitely successful in their math and science courses. And then, like I said, they're studying with students. And one of the things I truly feel is our students nowadays, they truly don't know how to study math. They don't. They think, okay, I'll just look over something, and they look over it, and they think that's good enough. Then that, you know, I studied, how many of you guys are, oh, well, I studied, and I studied so long and so hard for this, and I just keep not, you know, doing well. You know, I keep studying, and I'm like, well, what is it that you're doing? You know, so these cognitive skills where they are looking back at the process, you know, what they've done to get to where they're getting to, you know, and kind of say, okay, this kind of worked, but this didn't work, and let's move on to something different. I tell my students all the time, you're not prepared for an exam until you can sit down and you can actually write, and this is just for math for sure, that you can sit down and go through all the types of problems that we've talked about without having to look back in your notes. You know, it's like we may have to start, you know, and I have to start that way sometimes where I start a problem I don't remember, I gotta look back at my notes. But my students nowadays, they look back at their notes and they say, oh yeah, I remember that, okay, that was good. And then they go to the next one, but they never challenge themselves to let me try something else and see if I can start from start to finish without actually looking back, right? They don't challenge themselves to keep going. They just look back and or talk to their partner and their partner say, hey, do this. And they say, oh yeah, that's right. And then they move on to the next problem and they don't continue that. And then I tell them, so what happens, you get in your exam, and you get stuck, right? Because you can't look back at your notes right now. You never knew where you would get stuck because you never tried this at home. You know, and so many of them, I really have to push this. Guys, no, you really have to start. Can you do this problem from start to finish without talking to your neighbor, without looking? We may have to start that way, but you're not truly prepared until you can go from start to finish without looking back, because that's a trial run for you. And so that's something I think these skills, you know, just helping them gain that confidence, because our students nowadays, they get beat up so hard in math. You know, they try, they fail, and then they just get so down. And then so they try to, you know, move away from this, these types of courses. And these are things that we really want to push them. You know, we want to encourage that failure in the classroom, but we want to look back at it and see how we can correct these things. And these are things that we want to be able to definitely to help them with. And a couple of, so this is a something I like to use in my college algebra course. It's called a Frayer model. And many of you probably have seen something like that. So this is helping with that writing and that discourse. So say, for example, I'm talking about a new topic, or we're talking about equations or solving equations. And sometimes my students have a hard time determining what's an equation versus an expression. You know, and they never really think about that. You know, and so being able to define, so if I'm talking about an equation, what does an equation look like? What's its definition? Give me a fact about it. What does it actually look like? Give me an example. Give me a non-example. You know, it helps them to kind of put things in place. When you're talking about certain topics, you know, it helps them see, okay, this is what it must look like. Okay, this, you know, so they see the differences, and it helps them use their own words and see in different areas things that, different topics. And so I think that's something that's really good for our students to talk about, sometimes in groups or with each other, and come up with these types of things. And of course, there are many things that you can talk about. And the last slide is just a few different links, and I'll just really click on this last one. This Donna-Ford one is one where a lot of her work just talks about how to identify like gifted students. And there's lots of different, I'll encourage you to kind of go up there, look at some of the things that she has posted. She has things talking about critical thinking skills and certain things, and you know, just like I said, how to identify. And this last thing is curiosity machine. I came across this yesterday. I think it was kind of something really, really cool. So just a couple of minutes, and it's, I'll just hit this really fast. It's like a minute. Hold on. So, what you see is a little girl, she's trying to, you know, she wants to be curious, and she's actually talking about when she's trying to build a paper airplane, you know, a paper airplane. And she tries something, and she gets to talk with this real-life engineer that actually helps give her tips and different things to go about. And then, so they kind of go back and forth, and where she kinds to, she goes back and she changes her little design of her airplane a little bit. And so, this particular site, you can design problems where students can try to design different things and build different things. And they have a chance to actually contact and talk with different engineers and help them with their designs and different things. So I think these types of things are helpful to help them encourage them to go out and try new things and try to build things and to get that real life, words from someone else in that profession to see how to do it. And I think that will help stimulate some of them. A lot of times our students, what am I going to do with this? What's the real life? Where am I going to use this type of thing? And have these conversations from real life engineers or maybe real life scientists in those fields, I think it's something that would help definitely ignite some, passion in the sciences for many students. And I thought that this was something really neat. I definitely took a picture, sent it to my brother for my nieces to go look at. It's a really neat site for them. But like I said, just really cool stuff. And so that is pretty much the end of my presentation today. So thank you.